Okay, hello and welcome everybody. My name is Luis. Some of you already know me because of Open Day Live, but some others, I'm being in Open Day Live since the beginning, more or less. First of all, I was the little bit the coordinator for the system test in Open Day Live, as well as helping a little bit with the infrastructure. And lately, I'm mostly helping. I'm not having any responsibility. There's more some people that are here. But I'm still helping very much in these two areas, the test and the infrastructure side of Open Day Live. Of course, this is not the most fancy, you know, talk that you can have in this kind of congress or event, but it's good to see that there are still people interested in this kind of stuff, right? This is going to be a short presentation. I have very few slides, and what I would like to be is like a more interactive. Like when I present some slide, there are questions. You can ask every single slide any question that you see there, and I can spam more any kind of information. And then by the end of the presentation, it's also that I have put some ideas to work on the next release for infrastructure and tests. So again, you have more ideas, you have more things to share. That would be cool. Because yeah. I also say that there are people sitting here for infrastructure and tests. So if there are questions I don't know or someone can clarify something more that I can do, please go on. Very good. So yeah, so what is new? First, what is the agenda? So very simple, 3 points. Introduction, I will go through our continuous integration system. Next, I'm going to go what is new in Boron for those that are there. Some people in Open Day Live, you are contributing and you're supposed to be up to date about all the things that we did in Open Day Live. It's kind of difficult sometimes to catch up. So that's why I wanted to have this presentation for those people that are already in Open Day Live to have more view what's going on. And then what is next for Carbon? Like that's it. I mean, nothing really. So let me see. This is the... So this here, I don't know if people are familiar with this kind of diagram. So last summit, I have a full presentation, 25 minutes again, or something explaining this diagram, how the continuous integration actually works in Open Day Live, what is the pipelining of the different things that we do. Starting from, you know, on the left side, you have just very quickly. On the left side, you have the contributor that push that code, some code into the system. This goes to some SCM kind of code management, which is Git and Gerrit also. This actually triggers some kind of project build that is done by Jenkins. And this build needs some artifacts for sure that we download from Nexus. After that, the code gets verified. And then after the code gets verified, like there is no build issues, then there is the committer of the project that review the code. And then based on that, make a decision whether or not to merge the patch or get back to the committer to do something else. Once the committer merged the patch, there is another second build called, classic build called the merge build or something like that. And then again, you build one more time, but just to make sure that it is proper, like your code build again after the merge. And then you upload an artifact. So if the build is successful, you actually get your artifacts into the repository. So anyone else in Open Day Live that is using your project or your contribution, it can use the latest. And after that, you trigger what we call, there is a distribution build happening after that. So we take this kind of artifacts, new artifact, and then we create a new distribution. And then when we create a new distribution, we call the system test. Like we just deploy the new distribution and then we run some sort of black box test, like, you know, using simulated devices or whatever kind of thing we have for that. So any question already on the process that we have? Open Day Live, you know already, so this is nothing new. So if there is some new people, there's some question, well, probably straightforward. So what is new in Boron? So these are the things so there was an important change this release that everybody was in Open Day Live realized was the migration. Well, dynamic vice, I said dynamic VM system because today when we do testing and also when we do builds in Open Day Live, it's not like we are using a static VM system. So we are automatically getting this VM up and then do whatever job building or test we need to do. And then after that, we take those resources down. It's a way to have a more efficient use of the resources. And so far we have been using public cloud for everything, like building, testing, and so on, Rackspace. And there was an important migration happening in this release, and that was the migration of the build VMs to the private cloud. So what happened when, by doing that, what we gained, for instance, is we can use the OpenStack plugin versus the gCloud plugin. And these are desperate here. So they apparently have more control and stability in the VM lifecycle that we get when we use the OpenStack versus the gCloud plugin. So now, one of the things that we gain for sure after this is that the VMs spin and they go down very stable compared to before, at least the thing that are in private cloud. There is another thing we gain a little bit, a side effect of putting the build in the private cloud is that now everything that is test is still obviously in the other side, the public cloud. We have a separation now. So before everything seems to be in the same system, and now because of this separation, the build, which is probably more critical than the test, is happening in the private cloud while the all the test is happening in the public. And then there was another thing that I with the private cloud was that to use single use of gCloud. So this is just you get a fresh VM more or less every time. That before we used to reuse the VMs a little bit for whatever build or whatever we're doing, and now we are just getting fresh VM every time. This could be useful because sometimes if you don't clean up properly your system, the next time you spin up or use the same VM, then you can have some issue. But by doing fresh VMs and in a very quick way that we have today, or quicker than before with the private cloud, that is a good thing to do. The other thing that we gain very much is the Packer definition for dynamic VMs. It used to be like a background something before, and now we have Packer, which is a more standard way. And also by doing this, we also align all the kind of VMs we had in the system, like public and private VM, they use the same definition, as well as Sandbox. Sandbox, for those that they know, is like some kind of testing platform. We have to test jobs and new builds and new tests. And that platform, test platform, is also having the same VM definition. Any question on this? Cool. Jenkins. So our friend Jenkins has also some improvements. So the most important probably is the first one that we used to put everything on Jenkins. When something happened, like a bill or a test, whatever information comes from the bill or for the test, automatically, obviously, because of the Jenkins plugin, you get all that in Jenkins. But then if people mostly people, I believe, they are looking in Jenkins to get all this information after a bill, after a test, it got kind of slow. So there was a time in this release, I think, mostly like at the beginning, that there were a lot of issues, like people complaining Jenkins very slow, I cannot get whatever I want. So there was some work that those people are here, the one that did the work done, and that actually moved all this information to a log server. So now whenever we build or whenever we test, all the information that is being used and also whatever you produce after the job is uploaded to a log server. So that's a good thing. The second thing is migration to freestyle jobs. That is still ongoing. It's mostly done, but still thing is ongoing. And this is also some way to improve, especially the build of the code. Like with freestyle, you used to have Maven kind of job, and that has running some internal process to get more information about the build. And that seems to slow down. And there is another issue I heard, like the Maven plugin might not be supported anymore in Jenkins. So it's good that we are using freestyle jobs. Patch a string, we did some work with patching a string JJB to allow parallel updates. So it used to take some time to actually build all the jobs. So the way the jobs were in Open Daylight is all automatic. So in the past, we used to go to Jenkins and then configure one by one all the jobs. That was in the first release I was in Open Daylight. By the second release, they introduced something really cool, which is all the OpenStack JJB system, where you just write a JMO file and that automatically creates your job. So and then that was cool, but then after a while, I don't know how many jobs we had today, but many, many, many. Exactly. So building checking the 2,000 job and pushing the 2,000 job took quite a while, and now because of this parallel, it's pretty fast. So we can push all these jobs and update them very quickly. So that's cool. And then there's another thing, remove relaying the custom. Yeah, that was another improvement. Like we used to have some custom scripts for projects to generate their own jobs. And now all that gets standardized by using a standard JJB template. So that's also something good. I don't know if there is anything else or any question, but probably you have seen another thing that we did this release. I asked Tang already, but no question. So next one. So these are changes in the way we do build and test in Open Daylight. And so these are, for instance, daily auto release builds using a tag list. This is actually some very cool feature we got this release. Like before, it used to be like a big deal to run some script to a day. So just to create a release out of your normal development branch, we had to do a lot of like very complex process where you need to update with some patches, all the version, and then you need to tag release, and then you have to build. I mean, it was very complicated. And now that's got simplified very much with something called the tag list that you just create some kind of commits with the tag list, and then you just build on that, and then you generate that also in a daily fashion. I think I forgot, yeah, daily auto release. Before we didn't do that. We do release only when we need to release. But now there is this thing that we are releasing every day. And then whether we make one auto release build a release is something that the release team has to figure out when the moment happened. But today we are producing like daily release as a way to, you know, get continuous builds and working and that kind of thing. So that was really good. And then the second was the fast build. Yeah, it was another small thing, but also useful. We have some profile in Maven to really build faster all the Java code, which is the PQ. That was some committer pushing this. That was really good. From Red Hat. Michael. We have more rules for code check style, which is more for building Java and more check-ins there. Another thing we did for system tests is we are normally in the system pipeline that I saw in the beginning. Every time there is a merge in the system, we used to do and still we do a lot of testing jobs to make sure distribution is healthy. But it is too many, especially when you merge something in the upstream and there is a lot of dependencies. It's like every project that have a dependency used to run its own system test to make sure that nothing breaks after the merge. So with so many projects in OpenDaylight, we need to start to optimize the thing, otherwise it takes forever to test one merge or distribution in the upstream. So what we did is to have some kind of trigger based on the immediate offset. So if I'm merging something in offset one, I only trigger offset two projects, no any more further. I mean, in this case, yeah, offset two is the last one, but if we are in offset zero, for instance, it's only offset one that I'm triggering in case of test. So yeah, it's just a way to reduce the amount of test that I need to do when something gets merged in the system so I don't load too much with tests. There is another thing we did is the multi-feature test. It used to run also very often. Now we move that to daily, so that way we can save some resources and also test faster. Another thing we did this release is integration with external labs, and I'm not sure how many we have today, two or three? Two? Okay, yeah. So two external labs, they are integrating with Gerrit, so whenever we get a new patch, they are running their own tests in their own lab and produce their own test reports and that sort of things. So that's good because before we never, I mean, for some reason, well, we don't have this kind of request or we never manage it. But this is good that we have this, not only the cloud system in the OpenDaylight, but for some tests, you probably need to have your own lab. And there is the new dev packages that Daniel is here for packaging. So that was also something new, this release, produce a dev package for the OpenDaylight. RPM was already up before, so it's nothing. But for you, we have today the most common, let's say, packaging kind of artifacts. Cool. Any question on this?
We also have the patch test.
Yeah, so I'm going to explain this after, yes. Good point. So actually, you are right. This part is the most interesting part, because this is the part that everybody can actually see and use in OpenDaylight. Besides the hidden things that are happening in the infrastructure that are more hidden, this is more or less what the people can use. Something that people realize this release, that we had this distribution and validate auto release jobs, for good or for bad, because sometimes, I mean, it takes some time to do this validation, it's not for free, but it's not taking very long anyway. And what happened is that now when someone put a patch into the OpenDaylight system, it gets automatically a check for distribution, like, yeah, your patch can build and everything, but also when I put your patch into the distribution, it's not gonna break anything in the distribution. So this test was really needed, because in the past was like, you know, it was a lot of effort for the test people whenever there was a, you know, when something broke the distribution, very difficult to trace back and figure out which patch actually broke the distribution. And we managed to figure out all times, but it took some time, very much effort to do that. So that's why we decided to do the, and the same for auto release. So the build can happen for your project, but when you do an auto release with all the projects together, something can fail because there are dependencies between the different projects. So we decide to do, this is not a full auto release build because you need to build all the projects, but it's kind of maybe check for all dependencies. So and that takes not very long anyway. So this is for the two first. And then the multi-patch test job, which Jamo is here and he did actually this contribution, is on demand. It's not happening automatically like the other two. This is on demand, and the way this works is that you can build multiple patches, I mean things that are not merged yet, and then produce a distribution and then test that distribution. And this is not happening every day in OpenDLI, but it starts to be sometimes. Like to fix something or to get something done, it's not an individual project patch, you need to patch multiple projects. And because of that, this is very useful and new. And this, the last one was the project patch test job. That's also an interesting one. Like you see the pipeline explained in the beginning. Normally the system tests only happen when you do a merge, right? So you merge something and then you make sure you don't break anybody. You do some kind of system test to at least make sure of that. But sometimes we've realized many committers, you know, that they are reviewing code and before they actually merge the code, they want to make sure that nothing breaks. So because of that, we created this particular job per project. So every project can define a list of tests, system tests. And this is what it's doing is to build a patch without any merge and then pass create a distribution again and then pass a list of system tests so I make sure as a committer that this patch I'm reviewing is not breaking nothing that I care. So that's also something new in this release. Any questions so far? Very good. And this is another interesting thing for testing people, like robot test libraries. We really make, in my opinion, some good work this release towards more useful test libraries. So people, when they write a test, they don't need to start from scratch. And the most important one, there are more actually, but these are the ones that I consider more important when working this release. So we have complete new cluster test library, which all the thing that comes with the cluster, SAR, entity owner, cluster member operation, is kind of very decent size kind of library. So whatever thing you are thinking to do with the cluster is probably already there. So you are thinking in some cluster test, just look at this one. The other thing is, the second thing is also new, is a JVM monitoring library that the contributor for that I think was here. So yes. So this one was made by an intern of one of these intensive program, and this is also very cool. So no matter which job, it could be a performance regular job or some longevity that we are starting to do now. If we want to monitor how the memory, how the CPU, how the processes, threads, all the kinds of information, you just need to, you know, put these libraries to work. And it will take all the information for you. And the good news is that we tested these libraries in a way that it doesn't really introduce performance. It's very minimal. I mean, you cannot really appreciate any performance kind of degradation. Another thing is that this is using Decanter. So I see also the Karaf version. So this is fully using Decanter framework to get all the information from the JVM. And then there are two things we are doing here. One is automatically you get at the end of your job, your test or build, this is more for testing. At the end of your test, you get a plot of all the memory and all the CPUs. I mean, in theory, this framework allows you to get any information you can get today from JMX. So anything is possible. But we started just with CPU, memory, number of threads, and then number of classes, just to start with something. And the second thing is not only you can plot this, but also you can retrieve real-time data. So you are running a test, and at some moment you want to know exactly what is the CPU or what is the memory, it can give you that information, and then you can use that in your test to fail something, to pass something, whatever you want. And that's it. And new setup utils library is just, you know, new libraries for setup Caramf. This is also useful. You have running test case. You can log in the information in the Caramf console. So there is a new library for that. And also when you finish your test, if something failed, you can point to a bug. So this is also a cool feature that we can do now, like automatically when something failed, I mean, you need to put the bug number. It's not that happened automatically, but by writing this kind of keyboard, you automatically link a failure with a existing bug. So that's how it works. And then improved REST library, yeah, we have REST library you have from the beginning, but now we have very sophisticated REST library that they are not just taking a body and then passing that to the test. These are taking like templates where you can have variables and then they can chain that through the request. And this is also very useful as well as JSON normalization. So it's normalization. And then finally, it's an improvement in the SSH library because we are doing SSH very often in this kind of setup SSH to the mininet tools, to the some other VM that you use for testing. So there was some improvement also in the SSH. Any question? Cool. So yeah, this is done for whatever we are doing in this release. And then for Carbon, is also, this is the last kind of slide. So some of the ideas that I put here, and probably you have more, so that's why I would like to do this more interactive if possible. So some of the ideas I already have here is like, we need to probably move some of the tests to the private cloud. If there is some critical test that we are thinking that needs to run often or is kind of, we need to figure out still, but private cloud is more stable. It's clearly more stable. So it's something that we need to start looking at, if we can move some of the jobs to the private cloud. I mean, my opinion is that probably we need to do this in a gradual thing because private cloud obviously is more expensive. It's more, you know, limited in resources as well. So it's not like we can take everything and put it there. But maybe take a small step, identify what are the more critical things we are running and maybe sort of start moving some of this to the private cloud. The second thing is to continue with the JSKing speed up efforts. I think some things are going on as well to get more, Jenkins like more like almost like in the background and then using the log server and maybe some other tooling to get everything done as a front end. So that will really help out with the Jenkins. Improve CI pipeline using more Gerrit keyboard. Yeah, we discussed this we had some hafex before this summit and we were talking about how using some Gerrit keyboards, we could actually get a better, you know, pipeline, CA pipeline. Like, maybe I don't need to do all the distribution check, auto-validation that I was talking before for every patch that slows down a little bit. Maybe I can do that before I merge, for instance. Before I merge, I just run this kind of test and then I can do it. Another thing we need to work very much is an effective smoke test after code is merged, because today I think I have feeling that still we are running a lot of tests when something gets merged, so we need to probably speed up by doing some kind of a smoke test. Organizing the test libraries, although we have very cool libraries, we made this release, it has to be better organized and probably better documented so people can go there and easily use them, right? So that's something we discuss in the DDA for sure. That's another thing idea I came, that this is a recurrent thing, like improve project test status visibility. Yeah, this is always the thing, right? Like we have now we have more people doing system tests because Jemo commented before at some point, like today in OpenDay Live, you don't have a system test doing something, you are an experimental feature, obviously, and that's a good thing for users to understand what is experimental and not. But on the other hand, it's kind of difficult to track once you have a system test, so a little bit what is the level, the coverage, or I mean, what is exactly the status of your test. So we need to figure out this one, and this is a DDF topic as well, how we can get more understanding of the system, especially the system test. When it's happening, what kind of, you know, visibility we have on that. And then, yeah, performance test, I think this is not new, but we never got time to do well. Is the performance test that boy. We are running more and more performance tests. Now with the cluster, we plan to run even more in this release. And we still are missing some kind of dashboarding efficient way to show all these results to the community. So these are for me some of the, there are probably more, but these are at least some of the areas that we need to work towards in the next release. And it doesn't cover really controlled areas. This is all like infrastructure kind of things. There is another session with JMO on the DDF that we're gonna probably covering what are the test areas, specific test areas of the controller that we want to put some effort testing.
Tomorrow at 2:30.
Tomorrow is already? Okay.
2:30.
We don't
know where yet.
Okay, so tomorrow 2:30, is anyone interested, we're going to be talking about which area specifically of the controller could be, you know, whatever, cluster, longevity, any kind of test that we can do this release with, you know, kind of more priority or more important. Any question? Cool, so that was easy. Yeah, I think this is pretty much it. And
thought of a few other things that we did in the release as well.
Yes.
Read the docs, for example. We were moving.
Yes. So that was in a presentation before. I was planning to put the read the docs here, like a good thing, but because Colin was doing the previous presentation. But for those that are new, it's true. We have a complete new doc system now. Really cool, like nothing seen before in Open Daylight. So yeah, so that's another very cool feature.
You have those auto-generated robot docs.
Oh yeah, so because of that, yeah, that's a very good point. So because of that, we actually got very visibility, or at least automatic documentation of our robot test libraries. So when you write a robot test library, you normally write a small documentation, and we are, committers are normally looking at that to, that is actually done. But we never publish this kind of documentation. It's very hidden in the test code. But now with the new test infrastructure, we can publish all this information. Yeah. Actually, I think it's already available here. Let me show you. Docs, Google, no. Docs, automatic, but no. Yeah, Docs, Open Daylight. There you go. So this was probably presented before, and let me see if I can make it bigger as well. Not this one, this one. Oh, this one. Yeah, so you can see that in the existing documentation, we have the usual start guide, user guide, and all this kind of stuff that you do normally per release. But then there is some content here for infrastructure and integration testing. And this is, I think for integration is, this one. And then these are all the libraries that you can see today that we are, you know, we need to organize the libraries, obviously, because we have many. But there, any library like cluster I was mentioning before is full documented here, or at least try to do that. What are all the different keywords, what they stand for, the different variables that you use, arguments. So this is really cool. And these are our own created test libraries. Anything else, Daniel, you can think of? Or Jamo, anything else? For this release?
Packaging, we have Jenkins job for building RPMs, so everybody can build RPMs without having to set up your local system.
Cool. So it's like you download the code and then you build your own RPM?
No, you just type in parameters into a Jenkins job and it builds it on their
remote. Oh, Jenkins build for you. Yeah, that's cool.
We have the OpenStack templates.
Oh yeah, that too. Yeah, OpenStack job we did a lot this release. Actually, you were very much involved there. Yeah, there was a big push. This release, in terms of testing, we did a big push on the OpenStack, definitely. Some of the cluster tests as well has been a little bit. What we miss is, we discuss tomorrow, is probably some longevity stability test by the end of all. I really wanted to get that going, but because we are working in the framework for the JVM as well as we have other priorities, we never really work well on that part. But I probably spend some time in the next release for stability, just for stability. It's also that infrastructure, because it's a long, you know, long duration kind of test. We need to review that and look at how we're going to do it. Yeah, today is one day, and but it seems to be, we need to do more than one day. Okay.
So you think like Jenkins is like blocking the resource?
So Jenkins today is managing all the kind of, you know, triggers and then the actions in this CI system. It's not like it's blocking, it's that it was getting very busy, especially if you are using Jenkins to post all your results, to put all the information, and then you had the people also accessing that information. So there's been jobs, a lot of work actually being done by the infra people to move things out of Jenkins. And there is still more work coming, because I think the Jenkins needs to be, as I say, it's kind of background thing that nobody really see. And then you just see some kind of front end for Jenkins.
So one key point in that answer I think worth highlighting is that the Jenkins web UI builds the pages that you load in the same process space as it's doing other jobs and stuff, right? Or it's doing other work, basically. So if you as a user are hitting the web UI to browse around, you're causing the Jenkins server to do significant work that it wouldn't do otherwise. So we don't want people to do that very much.
So that's only happen when like the job is like too much and a lot of people is.
Well, I guess there's different types of bottlenecks that we can hit. There's also not enough resources overall, that we're spinning up too many VMs, we can have a big queue of VMs and stuff. Yeah. It's a different problem.
Yeah, we have too many jobs, as I say, but not too many. The thing, what we need, but a project like OpenDLI with so many contributions is it's getting very, very, very large, the amount of jobs. And probably you are running Jenkins in a small environment, even in a company for your small projects, so things, that it's okay. But in a large scale, I don't know. I mean, is there any other project using Jenkins as much as we are doing?
OpenStack was.
Yeah.
They were at over 8,000 jobs in Jenkins at the time.
Yeah.
We're at 2,000. Jenkins does okay to a point, but there comes a point where it just can't handle what you're trying to do because it's designed as a single, you're doing all this management of instances that are doing all the work, but it's not designed as a clustered system.
So yeah.
You don't have a clustered Jenkins. That's where you start running into problems when you just get to too high scale.
Cool. Very good. So if there are no questions, then can leave some time. I don't know what is the time for the next presentation. It's
about now?
Perfect. Just on time. Thank you. Okay, hello and welcome everybody. My name is Luis. Some of you already know me because of OpenDLI, but some others, I've been in OpenDLI since the beginning, more or less. First of all, I was the little bit the coordinator for the system test in OpenDLI, as well as helping a little bit with the infrastructure. And lately, I'm mostly helping. I'm not having any responsibility. There's more some people that are here. But I'm still helping very much in these two areas, the test and on the infrastructure side of OpenDLI. Of course, this is not the most fancy, talk that you can have in this kind of congress or event, but it's good to see that there are still people interested in this kind of stuff, right? This is going to be a short presentation. I have very few slides, and what I would like to be is a more interactive. When I present some slide, there are questions. You can ask every single slide any question that you see there, and I can spam more. Any question already on the process that we have? OpenDLI, you know already, so this is nothing new. So if there is some new people, there are some questions, well, probably straightforward. So what is new in Boron? So these are the things there was an important change, this release that everybody was in OpenDLI realized was the migration. Well, dynamic, I said dynamic VM system, because today when we do testing and also when we do builds in OpenDLI, it's not like we are using a static VM system. So we are automatically getting this VM up and then do whatever job, building or test we need to do. And then after we take those resources down. It's a way to have a more efficient use of the resources. And so far we have been using public cloud for everything. Make a decision whether or not to merge the patch or get back to the committer to do something else. Once the committer merged the patch, there is another second build called classic build called the merge build or something like that. And then again, you build one more time, but just to make sure that it is proper, your code build again after the merge. And then you upload an artifact. So if the build is successful, you actually get your artifacts into the repository. So anyone else in OpenDLI that is using your project or your contribution, it can use the latest. And after that, you trigger what we call, there is a distribution build happening after that. So we take this kind of artifacts, new artifact, and then we create a new distribution. And then when we create a new distribution, we call the system test. Like we just deploy the new distribution and then we run some sort of black box test, like, you know, using simulated devices or whatever kind of thing we have for that. So yeah, so let me see. This is the, so this here, I don't know if people are familiar with this kind of diagram. So last summit, I have a full presentation, 25 minutes again, or something explaining this diagram, how the continuous integration actually works in OpenDLI, what is the pipelining of the different things that we do. Starting from, you know, on the left side, you have just very quickly. On the left side, you have the contributor that push that code, some code into the system. This goes to some SCM kind of code management, which is Git and Gerrit also. This actually triggers some kind of project build that is done by Jenkins. And this build needs an artifact for sure that we download from Nexus. After that, the code gets verified. And then after the code gets verified, like there is no build issues, then there is the committer of the project that review the code. And then based on that kind of information. And then by the end of the presentation, it's also that I have put some ideas to work on the next release for infrastructure and tests. So again, you have more ideas, you have more things to share, that would be cool. Because, yeah. I also say that there are people sitting here for infrastructure and tests. So if there are questions, I don't know, or someone can clarify something more that I can do, please go on. Very good. So yeah, so what is new? This, well, no, first, what is the agenda? So very simple, 3 points, introduction, I will go through our continuous integration system. Next, I'm gonna go what is new in Boron for those that are there. Some people in OpenDLI, you are contributing and you're supposed to be up to date about all the things that we did in OpenDLI. It's kind of difficult sometimes to catch up. So that's why I wanted to have this presentation for those people that are already in OpenDLI to have more view what's going on. And then what is next for Carbon? Like, that's it. I mean, nothing really.